cameras are cheaper than ever, and it's definitely been a lot easier for people to get their hands on them. Maybe you want to experiment with them. People that dreams of becoming photographers or videographers, it's so much more accessible nowadays than it's ever been. And that's definitely a great thing. With the rise of smartphones still being a great entry-level way of getting into videography or photography, there are still other compact methods, some that get overshadowed a little bit due to the fact that smartphones are so powerful nowadays. And if you're staying on a budget, I always recommend Panasonic cameras, since in my opinion, they give you fantastic video quality, very sharp videos, the color science is on point in my opinion, so for a budget solution, Panasonic is usually the way to go. And today I wanted to put the spotlight on a camera that hardly gets any attention, but that is admittedly absolutely amazing, and that is the Panasonic Lumix LX10. This camera can do a ton. Forget the RX100, save your money, and consider this guy. Let's dive in. This video is sponsored by Feefine, the makers of some of the best audio gear on a great budget, like the ones from their C1 models featuring a professional-grade lavalier mic and the headset mics bundled together. Links to everything below. The exterior design of this camera consists almost entirely of metal, as a matter of fact. This camera feels really good to hold due to its very nice build quality. It feels expensive. It feels like it costs a lot more than it actually does, though when it was first released, it definitely was pricier than it is now. This camera is very hefty. The level of attention to quality shows in pretty much every aspect of the build on this camera. Everything about it just feels very premium. Even the screen itself, touching, swiping around with it, this camera is just built incredibly well, a lot smaller than something like my Pixel 4, for example. So this camera is definitely pocketable, even though it's way heftier than that phone. Overall, I do love this design. So as I've mentioned before, this is a touch-enabled display. And while it's not the best of Panasonic's display, it is still a pretty good one. So here, you got pretty small one, since this is a very small camera. This screen flips all the way out, and it flips in pretty much any angle you would want, but it only flips in a straightward position. It cannot flip over to the side or anything like that. Objects will look very sharp on this display, keep good track of focus through this display as well, and colors should look very nice on this display. It's also very nice to just tap around and navigate through the menus using the touchscreen, so it's a very smooth screen, and it is still a nice one. It's a good one to use. I like it. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the lens that this guy's using is actually a 24-72mm lens, and I love that it's got this little adjustment ring to meddle around with that in different shooting modes, which is very good. Now, because this is a 24mm lens, it is actually fairly decent for vlogging. It's not super wide, mind you, but it's still wide enough so that you can actually record yourself from arm's length and still get a very decent shot of yourself. There's still going to be a bit of a crop though if you're going to shoot at 4K, but if you're just shooting at 1080p, then arm's length is more than enough to capture things that are around you as well. So that's worth noting. I do really like what Panasonic did in terms of their lens technology here. It is just a fixed lens, by the way, since this is just a point-and-shoot camera. I think that we should go ahead and talk about its performance and actual recording. So I decided to test out two different modes, which is just 4K and 1080p. I primarily like to shoot in 4K, and I always shoot at 24 frames per second, so those are the samples that you're going to see. So for 4K 24, you get still very sharp videos with very nice colors, and this camera still does a great job at focusing. When you just tap to focus, it focuses a lot faster than a lot of other cameras, which is very good. It's very fast, and I'm very glad that Panasonic implemented this, and that it still works in the 4K setting. That is something that I really appreciate, because on something like Lumix G7, the focusing is actually a lot slower in 4K, even if on the LX10 is way faster, so that's very nice to have. Now, there is technically a stabilizer on this camera, but it is not a very good stabilizer. The footage is still going to look pretty shaky if you're going handheld, even though that is still technically my preferred shooting method, especially if I'm outdoors. It's just more convenient. It's not something that bothers me all that much, but sometimes I do find myself wanting to have something more steady, more stable, to ensure that I am getting the best shot I can possibly get. That is worth noting, but overall I'm very happy with the performance in 4K. Now as for performance in 1080p, you get to shoot at up to 60 frames per second in 1080p. And as far as I can tell, videos still look incredibly sharp, and you do get a little bit more of a wider shot, considering that in 4K, the frame is actually cropped up a little bit for some reason. But in 1080p, you get the widest shot that this camera will allow you to get, which is still very sharp, very colorful. I'm still very happy in this setting. Focusing is still accurate, and you still get options for adjusting the white balance here, which still helps if you want to correct some of the colors in the camera, but you're probably better off doing most of that in post anyway. I'm very satisfied with their performance in both 4K and 1080p modes. I think that this camera does a fantastic job there. However, there is a big issue with videos, and it's just the fact that this camera captures a ton of light. It's almost impossible to actually fix that issue just within the camera software alone. Adjusting the exposure doesn't do much, reducing the ISO, it doesn't really quite look right no matter what you do if you're outdoors and the sun is just very strong. So do keep that into consideration that under the best scenarios, you'll probably want to have an ND filter for this. This would be required if you want to record professional video using something like this, which is possible with this camera, but it does need a little bit of help in that department. So do keep that into consideration. That glare and overexposure is a pretty big issue here. And in terms of battery life, you do get a pretty standard affair. Each battery will last you at around 1 hour of straight up recording, though turning it on and off back and forth does help saving a little bit of batteries. Now, battery life isn't really that big of an issue for me because I always purchase extra batteries with whatever camera I buy. So I purchased an extra 2 batteries for this camera, so I'm always safe. So now in terms of complaints, there are still quite a few to mention, and one of them is that this camera does not have a microphone jack, not even a headphone jack for that matter. That means that you cannot connect any source of audio to this camera, which is a pretty big deal if you want to use this for vlogging, since it has a flip-out screen, which is very nice for those purposes exactly, but you're going to have to rely on the internal microphones or get an external recorder for that, which is less than ideal since the internal audio is not very good, and I hate having to travel with external audio devices anyway. There's also about a 15-minute time limit for recording in 4K, which can be a little bit of a nuisance. Most of the shots that I take actually don't require me to record for 15 minutes at a time, so I'm actually okay there, but sometimes I have had to use this camera for shooting for longer than that. So constantly having to restart the video after it reaches the limit is a bit of a nuisance. That is worth noting in 1080p. I'm not sure if there is a limit or not, but I haven't had that issue at all. So that is worth noting as well. Also for Panasonic, menus are still a little bit clunky. I really prefer the way that Sony does their menus for that matter, as Sony does a really good job of just categorizing everything and putting those into where they're supposed to be, when Panasonic does have things sprung around in different sections of the menus and things get lost very easily there. So I don't love the menu system here either. Another thing to mention is that you do get stabilization with this camera, but it's not very good stabilization. In fact, it's very weak and mediocre. So a gimbal might actually be useful for this, or some kind of tripod to hold this up. So yeah, this camera isn't perfect. Properly reached the conclusion of this video, I have to say that this little guy has actually been a travel companion of mine for a very long time now. I always carry this guy around in my bag with me in case I want to shoot videos without having to use my phone, since I would rather conserve the battery of that guy. But I can always rely on this camera to get very crisp footage, great colors, even if the overexposure is a bit of a problem, and it's probably my biggest complaint aside from it not having a microphone port. Probably won't be doing too much vlogging with this moving forward, as a pocket run and gun solution that is so compact, that fits so well, and that works so well for me, this camera is absolutely worth it. I was interested in the Sony RX100, the Mark 7, but those cameras are getting excessively expensive and I can't see myself investing $1,200 on just a point and shoot. Might as well spend that on a Sony A6400, which is what I've done here. So for a camera of that style, the Panasonic Lumix LX10 is the best one that you can get instead of the RX100. Though you should also take a look at Canon's lineup, since they've got some great stuff cooking up at the moment. However, Panasonic Lumix LX10, highly recommended. So if you're interested in purchasing the LX10, then I will be making sure to leave affiliate links to Amazon in the description. If you do use our links to make a purchase, then we do get a small commission that does help us run things a little more smoothly around here. So if you were to use those, we would very much appreciate it. This has been Francisco from Tech Summit. Thank you for watching, and I'll be seeing you all later. Enjoy.